Congressman, thank you for talking to us.
Well, thanks for having me.
How's it going?
We're excited. Things look very well right now. We've been spending the last several months getting out and about to all four corners of the state, and there's a lot of momentum on the ground right now, a lot of energy for this campaign, and we just have a little over 3 weeks to finish strong.
You got the Denver Post endorsement.
We're excited about the Denver Post endorsement. I think it says a lot about our ideas, our passion, and this race. And certainly, though, the endorsements that matters are those endorsements that will be mailed into the ballot, placed at the polls on November, between now and November 4th.
Yeah, you got a long voting time. It's very different this year.
We do. You know, it was described by somebody on my campaign not as a election day anymore, but an election deadline.
How do you know who benefits from that, whether you or the Democrats benefit?
Well, I think it benefits whoever's most organized. I mean, if you're a organization that hasn't put the time in on the ground or the time in to make sure that you're getting your vote out, then you're not going to benefit from it. But if you're somebody who has been organized, been on the ground, making sure you're putting the pieces in place, then it should show some results for you.
Why did you get in the race so late?
You know, a year ago, my wife and I had said no to this campaign. We had felt we had more work to do in the state legislature. I come from a very safe House seat, a Republican House seat, serve on a great committee, Energy and Commerce Committee, a lot of great work that we'd been doing. But over the course of that year that we had said no, we watched as the Senate continued to block the legislation that we had passed. It continued to stop bipartisan proposals that we had put forward. And I felt that the one way that we could really change the direction this country is heading wasn't by staying in a safe Republican House seat, sending out fancy press releases about legislation that would never see the light of day because of Harry Reid, but it was about changing the majority, about becoming number 51 so that we could actually do something to move this country forward for the people of this nation.
Is your campaign about defeating Mark Udall, who's the incumbent senator, or trying to get that majority? If you, for instance, were to win, but you didn't get that majority because of losses in other states, would you have accomplished what you set out
to do? Well, it's about defeating Mark Udall. Obviously, somebody who has supported the president 99% of the time, who has voted for Obamacare, who's voted for tax increases, regulatory increases, somebody who supports a carbon tax, making it more difficult for Coloradans to make ends meet. He's voted against the Keystone XL pipeline four times. And so this election is about what we can do to move forward. But it starts, obviously, by making sure that Mark Udall is coming back to Colorado instead of going back to Washington.
Well, you know, the same time the Denver Post endorsed you, they also endorsed John Hickenlooper. I wonder if that tells us something about Colorado.
Well, Colorado is a state that, you know, a lot of people want to say it's blue or it's red or it's purple, but it's always a state that has done its own thing. It's always voted for the person that it believed wears well with the state and who's going to put solutions. It's a very solution-centric state. I think it's a state, going back into our history, you look at a state that elected Bill Armstrong, one of the leading voices on the conservative side of things, elected Tim Worth around the same time, one of the leading voices on the liberal side of things. It elected Ben Campbell as a Democrat, elected Ben Campbell as a Republican. And so it's a state that does what it believes is best for its people.
So how do you make that appeal? How do you get them to switch in the right direction as far as you're concerned?
Well, I think it's a couple things. Number one, we talk about our ideas. We talk about our vision. We've been going around the state touting a Four Corners plan, something that highlights economic development, energy independence, talks about education opportunities for our children and what we can do to protect the incredible environment that we cherish here in Colorado. But it's also then about contrasting what has happened in the past. Senator Udall has been there for 16 years, and over the past 6 years in the United States Senate, we've seen his plan. And under his plan, Coloradans are out of work. They're struggling to make ends meet. Median household income has declined. Our debt has increased. The world is less safe and secure. That's his plan, and that's the contrast that we present.
And yet so much of this debate is about reproductive issues, about what they call women's issues.
Well, that's Senator Udall's campaign. Senator Udall is a social issues warrior. He wants to talk about nothing else. It's something that they campaigned on 4 years ago when Michael Bennett was running in Colorado. It won then. They did it again in 2012, and so they think that same playbook will win again in 2014.
Why won't it?
Well, I think that people have seen through it. The people of Colorado are smarter than that because they've watched what happens under Mark Udall's plan. You want to talk about the real war on women, let's talk about the failed economic policies of Barack Obama and Mark Udall. Thousands of women around the state can't find the kind of jobs that they're hoping for, the kinds of opportunity that they're looking for. They were promised they could keep their health care plans, their doctors, that their cost for health care would go down. Simply not true. That was a promise that Mark Udall made.
Do you think that if this personhood amendment, this ballot initiative that's on the ballot this year, if that were to be voted down again, does that hurt you?
Absolutely not. Look, it's been overwhelmingly defeated. I don't support it. And it's something that I think the people of Colorado will once again defeat.
Now, you know, the Democrats say that you don't support the state version, but you support the federal version, which is essentially the state.
Well, the Democrats are trying to say all kinds of things, but that's a statement that I support life. I don't support the personhood amendment. What they're trying to do is simply distract the voters from their failed policies. They can't talk about the economy. They can't talk about energy because they're on the wrong side of those.
The Colorado economy is not doing so badly.
If you look at what's happening, though, around the state, you look at Denver, construction cranes on the skyline,
yeah.
It looks good. But really, when you scratch that surface, when you get to what's happening beneath, look, it's been over the past several years, median household income in Colorado has declined by over $4,000. If you're in Pueblo, Colorado, your unemployment rate at the beginning of this year was almost 7%. Median household income in Pueblo County is about $30,000. The statewide average is about $60,000. People are working fewer hours a week because of Mark Udall's passage of Obamacare. In fact, the University of Colorado, his hometown, just announced that they're cutting back hours so they don't have to pay workers under the mandate of Obamacare. And so you see this real suffering as gas prices go up, as food prices go up, as college tuition increases, people working harder and harder each and every day to make ends meet, and they just feel like they're falling behind. Senator Udall has done nothing to solve that. The middle class hasn't gotten a raise since 1999 in this country. We can do better.
How much does it help you that Barack Obama is so weak?
Well, it's not. Well, obviously, the president has his policies have hurt this country. His policies, from an economic standpoint, from a national security standpoint, made this country less safe and secure. But just a few days ago, when the president himself says that his policies, each and every one of them, are going to be on the ballot, Mark Udall has voted for those policies 99% of the time. This election is a referendum on those failed policies that Mark Udall has supported hook, line, and sinker.
And the president said that. Was it a gift?
I think he stated it correctly. The fact is the people of this country will go to the ballot, to the polls, early voting, mail voting, whatever it's going to be, and they're going to decide whether they like the direction of this country, whether they're satisfied with the way things are, and whether they're satisfied with people who have given him all of their votes, followed him all the time, 99% of the time in this case. And if not, then they're going to go in a new direction. And I believe that our message of that new direction, a new generation of leadership, is appealing across the state.
What do you say to the voters we talked to in the past couple of days who say to us, they're both accusing each other of being extreme, and I'm tired of that conversation?
Well, in fact, we have a TV commercial up right now that talks about how this election should be about more than Senator Udall has made it. We should talk about the economy. We should talk about energy, education, the environment. And that's what we have focused on, and we'll continue to do that as we hit the remaining days of this campaign.
It's a midterm election. People are not as engaged in midterm elections as they often are. How do you get them engaged?
Yeah, it's the old-fashioned way. I mean, this is with the advent of, you know, how many satellite television channels you can choose from, how many internet sites you can choose from. There's so much information out there, information overload. How do you reach the voter?
Exactly.
You do it the old-fashioned way. It's about going door to door. It's making phone calls. I made up a few words the other day. I said, we will leave no door unknocked and no phone uncalled. But those are the kinds of things that we have to do to make sure that we win this election. When we received not only the Denver Post endorsement, but we've received the Colorado Springs Gazette, the Greeley Tribune, the Pueblo Chieftain, the Grand Junction Sentinel. All of those newspapers around this state have said, we need a new direction. We need somebody who can go out and reach and reconnect leadership in this country. And it begins by getting Washington out of Colorado and more Colorado into Washington. That's the message that we get door to door.
But you've been in Washington. Why are you different?
But if you look at the solutions that we have stood for, an agenda of trying to get government out of the way, let America work, free up our energy economy, passing bipartisan legislation, was named a no-labels problem solver seal of approval, that bipartisan organization. And so I'm not afraid to buck the party. I'm not afraid to reach and work across the aisle. And people recognize that.
But you are a member of a caucus of House Republicans who were responsible, in some part, for shutting down the government, and were seen as being obstructionist.
Yeah, again, I voted for every measure that would have avoided the shutdown, supported efforts during it to make sure that we were finding ways not only to get out of the immediate situation, but to make sure that we developed long-term solutions. There was a bipartisan group of us, both relatively new members of Congress, Democrats and Republicans, that tried to put in place long-term reforms of spending, of tax reform, so that we could create a long-term budget to get out of the mess. I was one of the handful of Republicans who voted to end the government shutdown, and I took a lot of heat from my own party because I was willing to step up and do the right thing for Colorado.
How much of this this tight race would you attribute to it being about anti-Udall or anti-business as usual or anti-whatever we've lived with and not pro-Gardner?
Well, again, I think it's the people are found themselves our message appealing. They like what we're talking about in terms of focusing on the economy. They like our plan of trying to help people make ends meet. And so it really is a fact that we can get people back on their feet, and Senator Udall has failed to do that, even though he promised that he would do that.
If you make it into the United States Senate, can you see yourself working across party lines?
Absolutely, we have to. Look, the Senate, the House, this country is a better, stronger place when we work together. I think it was Chris Christie who said, it's hard to hate up close. And that's what we have to do to make a government that people can be proud of again. And that's what is missing from this nation. People look at Washington and with a groan or a sigh, instead of looking at it and say, you know what, I'm glad we sent them there because they're doing the right thing and I don't have to worry about them because they're out of the way. That's what we need to be doing.
Congressman, thank you very much.
Thanks for having me.